Dictionary had for Laity Sunday an additional scripture, and I want to share with you this morning Luke 10, verses 1 through 11, and it can be found in your pew Bible on page 1611. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them on ahead of him, two by two, into every town and place where he himself was about to go. And he said to them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. Go your way. Behold, I am sending you out as lambs during wolves. Carry no money bag, no knapsack, no sandals, and greet no one on the road. Whatever house you enter first, say, 'Peace be to this house.' And if a son of peace is there, your peace will rest upon him. But if not, it will return to you and remain in the same house, eating and drinking what they provide for the laborers deserve his wages. Do not go from house to house. Whenever you enter a town and they receive you, eat what is set before you. Heal the sick in it and say to them, 'The kingdom of God has come near to you.' But whenever you enter a town and they do not receive you, go into its streets and say, 'Even the dust of your town that clings to our feet, we wipe off against you. Nevertheless, know this, that the kingdom of God has come near.'" May the Lord add his blessings to the reading of his holy word. There's a story about two missionaries who were going door to door. They knocked on the door of one woman who was not happy to see them. She told them in no uncertain terms she did not want to hear their message, and she slammed the door in their face. To her surprise, however, the door did not close. In fact, it bounced back open. She tried again, really putting her back into it, and slammed the door again with the same results. The door bounced back open. Convinced that one of the missionaries was sticking his foot in the door, she reared back a third time to really give it a slam. She felt this would teach them a lesson. But before she could act, one of them stopped her. He said, "Ma'am, before you do that again, you really should move your cap." We don't see many door-to-door evangelists anymore. Most people don't want to be bothered with strangers at our door. In fact, just last week, I saw a lady in our neighborhood going door-to-door with brochures in her hand. I was getting in the car to leave. Actually, I was coming up here to bring items to the yard sale. I was doing my Christian duty. I didn't want to be bothered with this woman. I didn't care what she was doing. She was in my neighborhood. But when I got home later that day, I found on my doorstep a card, a devotion book, and a brochure about her church. She was inviting people to come to their church. I must say, I was impressed. She was out spreading the word. She was not a young lady, and she was small in stature, but she was on a mission. We live in a world that is very different than the one in which Jesus appointed 70 and told them to go out two by two into the towns and villages from house to house. He told them to heal the sick and to tell everyone who would listen that the kingdom of God is near. Jesus sent out advanced men to prepare the way and to excite the people. The disciples represented the universal mission to all nations, including the Gentiles. their discipleship had a multiplying effect because people wanted to hear the message. These men were delegated to discover the new opportunity that was there to bring the message to people. You know, sometimes we in the church are not willing to follow some of Christ's directions. Are they too difficult? Do we only want to do what is the easiest? What we fail to do most often is not to really ask something in Jesus' name and expect to come true. We only respond in partial faith, or we try to make our desire God's desire. The task that Christ gives us is not easy, but He helps us and He supports us. Nothing is impossible with Christ. Jesus modeled the Great Commission to us. He sent out the 70. Or in Luke 10, it says 72. These disciples went out in a vulnerable fashion. They didn't have wallets. They didn't have bags. They didn't even have sandals. It was necessary for them to open to the hospitality of those to whom they were sent. They stayed with their host, and they ate whatever was offered to them. They heard people's stories. They responded to needs. They healed the sick. And they shared hope by proclaiming the message of God. Did they wait for people to step through the door of the temple? No. Jesus sent them out to reach out and receive new people into the kingdom of God. Jesus taught them how they were to go and to make new disciples. In our Choosing the Faithful Path class on Monday night, we touched on this very thing. How do we at Northview reach out to the neighborhood around us? We found that we do in some ways reach out, but we also found that in many ways we're lacking. You see, by appointing 70, Jesus was announcing God's intention to take the news to the entire world. They were sent in pairs because their work was difficult, even with helpers. These men were sent into a vast field with very few workers to help them. They were to pray for more laborers to join them, just like we must pray for more helpers today, when we fulfill that same mission. They were successful in their first attempt at spreading the gospel. They conquered their fears and did what they were told. We must go into the world because there are people in great need. We must go out as caring people who identify them in their hurt and their need. We must go out with hope and realization when we minister to the least, we encounter Christ. When we feed the hungry or visit the sick or the prisoners, we obey Christ. He calls us to identify with those He came to save. The worst thing we can do is make a person who is in need or in the middle of a crisis feel rejected or inferior. Jesus knew these men would stand out and was counting on it because they had a message to share, a message that was so vital and so life-changing that everyone needed to hear it. People still need to hear that message today. When we are changed by our encounter with Christ, we have the authority and the responsibility to tell everyone by our words and our lifestyle that God has touched our lives and will touch theirs. Jesus told the messengers to proclaim the rule and reign of God's people's hearts. He tells us to proclaim that same message today. We do this by respecting one another, by living in loving relationships, by working to bring about social justice, and reflecting the image of God in our words and our deeds. Friday night, and Connie doesn't know I'm going to tell this, but Connie reached out to someone. She bought one of Jane Lambert's wonderful little apple pies. She went to Wendy's, and she said a young man saw that pie on her car seat. And he says, "Man, that looks good." Connie gave it to him. She came back over and bought another one. That was the way Connie was showing what God has told us to do. She was showing love, even to someone she didn't know. As we pass through the various stages of our lives and the changes they bring, we are still disciples who have been sent to proclaim the good news. God has sent us along with His presence in the form of the Holy Spirit. The only way to understand the Christian life is to live in it. It can only be understood if we follow Christ's example in the homeless shelter, at the local food bank, at a hospital bed, or with a friend or neighbor who has just lost a loved one. We do this as ordinary, fragile human beings. We need to give witness to God with our whole lives, especially since we don't know when we'll have an opportunity to show God's love. We're called to be faithful witnesses. All we must do is tell people about the love of Jesus. We are not to do this alone. He's given us our church community and support. This is a network that we can share our journey with. A preacher was speaking at an open-air crusade in Halifax, Nova Scotia. Billy Graham was to be the speaker the following night. But he arrived a day early. He came unannounced, and he sat on the grass with the crowd. In front of him was an elderly gentleman who seemed to be listening attentively to the preaching. When the call came for people to come forward and to make a commitment to the Lord, the gentleman did not move. Dr. Graham tapped the man on the shoulder and asked, "Would you like to accept Christ? I'll be glad to walk down with you." The man shook his head. "No, I think I'll just wait until the big gun shows up tomorrow night." In the thinking of this man, and in the thinking of many people, winning souls for Christ is something that should be reserved for the big guns. Today's gospel story shows us that mission is for everyone, the clergy as well as the laity. We are called to be missionaries for Christ. People of all ages still follow Jesus today. Christ seeks us not in the temple courts of the sacred and the sanctified, but in the secular, sinful world. We're called to travel light on the road of faith. Too much stuff can be a problem. The more we accumulate, the more our freedom is restricted. The more attached we are to our stuff, the harder it is to hear the call of Jesus. Churches are also called to be in mission, to be about the business of evangelism, to hear Jesus' instruction, and to travel light. Sometimes churches get so bogged down with business and concern and facilities, so many other details, that we can miss the voice of the Lord, just like busy people can. A young hospital chaplain was serving his internship in a large teaching hospital. While on call was summoned to the room of a woman whose baby had been stillborn just a few hours earlier. "We want our baby baptized," the young woman said. She was cradling her lifeless daughter, her husband at her side. "Her name is Nicole." The intern didn't know what to do. He asked the young parents to wait a few minutes and then come to the chapel. Meanwhile, he tried to find a more experienced chaplain to take over. He was not successful. What was he to do? What was he to say? Baptize a stillborn? The situation had not been covered in either his theological training or in his training in pastoral care. He tried to think of what he could say to minister to this young grieving couple. But when they arrived at the chapel, the words he had hoped to say just did not come. Instead, and almost without realizing what he was doing, he took a tissue. He wiped at the tears of the young parents, and he wiped his own tears. And then he touched the tissue to the baby's head. "Nicole, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit." He said nothing else. The tears were more eloquent than words could have ever been. We must be willing to discover new opportunities for doing God's work in our world. We have often heard the motivating words of Jesus, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few." Indeed, the field is ready for the harvest, and the Lord of the harvest wants you and me out in the field. God wants us to take hold of the countless opportunities and challenges around us to bring glory to the Lord of the harvest. On Laity Sunday, we celebrate that we are all called, laity as well as clergy, to go and make disciples. We're called to be the church together in a world so desperately in need of hope. We must move the obstacles that keep us from doing the command of our Lord. Just as the lady needed to move the cat to shut the door, we need to move the obstacles that get in our way from going out and spreading the good news of our God, who loves us beyond anything we can imagine.